Hello and welcome to part two of the Our Model Railway series. As you can see, got the boards and the wood for the baseboard. So all I need now is to go and grab my tools and we can start building. I'll see you in a moment. I think I've got all the tools that I'm going to need for today's job, and I suppose all we need to do now is get on and start building the baseboard. However, before I do, I just want to have a quick talk about what else you're going to see in the video this month. Well, in last month's video we looked at some of the old locos that I had, and one of the things that I'm going to be doing this month is servicing the Hornby 08 Shunter that we looked at in the last video. It'll be the first time I've opened it in about 40 odd years, so I don't know what I'm going to find inside, but hopefully once we've serviced it, done any repairs that we need to do, we should see it running at the end of the video. So, baseboards. As like most people starting out on the world of model railway, and I looked on many of the forums, watched videos, read a number of articles, and it appears that if you ask two model railway enthusiasts how to build a baseboard, you'll probably get five different answers. It does seem to be a matter of contention. Lots of debates on the various forums and on the various YouTube channels. So, how am I going to build a baseboard? Well, I'm going to build a baseboard based on what I think looks like it'll work, and which is within the skills of my very limited carpentry. So I'm going to use, to begin with, for the main base, I've got some 12mm ply here. The ply that I'm using is, as I say, it's 12mm, and it's about 4 foot by 2 foot in size. As I said again in the last video, space is going to be quite limited for me, certainly initially. So I've gone for quite a small baseboard. I may extend it by another 4x2 as we go on through the building of the model railway, but that will depend a lot on the space that becomes available and how easy and how much I can fit onto this particular baseboard. So 12mm ply, and the current piece here is about 4 foot by 2 foot. For the supporting structure, so the main frame for the baseboard, I'm using some timber, which I'll take a look at now. Well, this is the timber that I'm going to be using. It's 1¾ inch by 3/4 inch in depth, so 1¾ inch wide by 3/4 inch depth, and I'm going to use that to build the frame. My intention is to obviously build a frame that goes around the entire outside of the board, but then also to have some strengthening struts cutting across the middle at about every 12 inches. So that's my intention to do, building with these. So, and then for the legs, I've got some 1 inch by 1 inch diameter wood for the legs, and I'm hoping that will be sturdy enough. I may use a piece of this to brace across the two arre legs. Obviously, when I'm building the frame, one of the things that I need to consider is, as well as making sure that the baseboard is strong and won't warp, but also where I'm going to be putting the points. So the point mounters that go underneath, clearly don't want to be directly on top of one of these, otherwise I'm not going to get the point mounter to work. So, but we'll come on to that when we look at the track layout in the next video. So I shall start measuring up and I shall start doing some cutting. Well, I've got a couple of boards set up, just about to measure up the first piece, 1,220 millimetres, 120 centimetres, which is around about 4 foot. So I shall just mark this off. set square. Draw a line. That's the waist at the moment, so I know to cut to the side. The reason I mark the waist bit there, I'm sure you're all aware of this, it's just so I know I need to cut to the outside of the line, to the waist side of the line. If I cut this side, it'll be too short. I can always sand it down a bit afterwards. So what I'll do is I'll measure up the rest of the wood and I'll start cutting. And while I'm doing that, I'll hand you over so we can have a look at the OH shunter being serviced. And I'll see you once I've finished cutting. Thank you. Thank you. Hello again. Carpentry never was my strong point, so we're not disturbed too much by the noise of the sawing and drilling. Anyway, welcome over to the workbench. In the last video we took a look at this class 08 that I said I would try and service, so I shall get started on that now. This is the first time it's been opened in probably the best part of 40 years, so let's open it up, have a look and begin servicing it. A little bit of intrepidation here because I've never really serviced a loco before, and certainly I think I've had the covers off of these when I was a young lad, but that's about the last time. So, any further ado, let's get started. Well, here we are. Here's the class 08 shunter. It's model number, yeah, I believe, is R152. I've had a look at the servicing sheet and it looks relatively simple. In order to access the engine, all I need to do is to move one screw in the rear here. I don't know if you can see the screw that's just in the rear. And then the cover should lift off. Like I say, first time I've opened this up for at least, I would guess, at least 40 years, so I don't know what I'm going to find inside. Hopefully it won't be in too bad a state. So let's just remove this small screw. I should do is just to keep it safe, I'm going to just drop it in an old fish wagon there that's from my old stock. I might have shown that in the very first video. So here it is. In order to take it off, it just lifts up, and there's two connection hooks at the front just here that it hooks over. So that's simply it. This body shell. Let me just move the engine out of the way for a second because I just wanted to show you something on the body shell. As you can probably see, the shell has got a little bit damaged over the years, so there's a where the screw comes in, it's obviously a weak spot and it's got cracked, and it's sort of cracked down from there and there's a bit missing. What I think I will do is when I come to assemble it is probably put just inside here a little bit of thin plastic, glue a little bit of thin plastic just inside the area here, and then fill it from the outside. Never done any real modelling, so I'm hoping that will work. Do let me know in the comments if you think that will do. Clearly I need to make sure that I leave the space for the screw to go in. So let's put the body out of the way. We're going to give that a clean up with just some bit of detergent, so washing up liquid and a toothbrush, something like that, just to give it a quick, a good clean up. So we'll move that out of the way and let's have a look at the motor and chassis area. Well, as I say, first time I've opened it, my initial thoughts is it doesn't look too bad. However, it's fairly obvious that the brushes are missing. In here there should be two brushes, and they're missing, so we will need to get some spare brushes for it. And also it appears that one of the wires has come detached from somewhere. So we've got a red wire that goes to a little sort of plate here, a red wire that goes to a plate, and that plate connects to this side here, the positive side of the brushes. And then there's a brown wire that appears to be connected to the red wire via a connection at the back here. So it's obviously, I'm not sure whether they're supposed to both be connected to the same place or whether the brown wire goes somewhere else. So what I think I will need to do is I need to get a photograph of this, a little bit of a close-up photograph. I shall post it on the forum and ask for somebody to guide me as to where this ought to be soldering. I wasn't planning to start doing any soldering for a little while, so I guess I'm going to have to start sooner than I expected. So anyway, here's the engine. I think it's an X04 engine, I think is the terminology for it. In order to remove it, at the rear here, there's a... Just try and get those wires out of the way. There's a small screw at the rear here, and that should, if I'm correct, according to the service thing, if I remove that, that should allow the engine to come out. So I should just do that now. Few problems there because of the magnet here, and I've got a screwdriver that is magnetic. Maybe I need to get some more screwdrivers, some non-magnetic screwdrivers that would allow me to get that out relatively easy, a bit easier than keep constantly being attracted to the magnet. And I think that's probably just about where we are. The screw is out. Once again, I'll put that screw into there. I must remember that the small screw goes into the thing and the large screw is the connection one. Right now, apparently you can just pull this out. Oh, there we go. It is out. And there's the two wires. At least it will make it easier for soldering, I would hope, with that out. So here's the body. I'm just having a look down. Inside, there's a little connection down there, a little sort of connection point. I'm assuming that the body acts as the earth, or sorry, the negative side, and in terms of the connection. But there we go. So there's the body. I'll just move that out of the way, and then we'll have a look at the engine. Anyway, there's the motor. I believe it's an X04 motor, as I've said. So we need to now start cleaning this. In order to do that, we need to mainly clean the area around here where we've got the where the brushes connect to, and there are some small grooves in there. I don't know if you can see them in this particular light. I'll try and zoom in a bit to show you, but there are some small grooves that will also need clearing out with a small piece of wire or a pin of some sort, and then it will need, once we've done that, it will need re-oiling. Minimum amount of oil. There are a number of pads on this particular motor. So there's a pad at the front here where the oil goes, and then there's a pad at the rear here, which is where the oil goes. So they both appear relatively dry, so I shall put the oil onto those and may just put a little drop on the small cog bit here at the front. So what am I going to use to clean it? Well, I've looked on a number of videos of people servicing this particular type of motor, and most people have done a mixture of either using some alcohol, and it's an IAI, I think, alcohol, so isopropyl, anyway, so can't really pronounce it, but some alcohol, some pure alcohol for cleaning it, and others have used a general cleaning fluid. I'm planning to use the alcohol initially. If it doesn't come clean, I may then go and get some fluid. The alcohol apparently is less damaging, and particularly around plastic areas, so which is one of the reasons why I'm planning to use alcohol. So I shall get that prepared now and be back to you once I'm ready to start clearing it. Right, well, welcome back. I've poured out a little drop of the alcohol. This is the stuff that I'm planning to use. So I don't know if you can see what it says on there, but that's what we are planning to use to clean it with. I'll let you know where I got this from in the comments in or in the description of the video. So I've poured a little bit of this out into a small tub, and then what I now need to do is, using the obligatory cotton bud, is to try and start cleaning the various bits of it. So I shall just dip the cotton bud into the alcohol and we'll see how this goes. I've never done this before, so let's have a look at how this goes. So as I'm rubbing it, it does appear that a fair amount of gunk is coming off on it. I don't know if you can see that, but a fair amount of gunk is coming off on it. So I'll just give it another couple of rubs round. Keep turning this to make certain. So certainly a fair old amount of gunk on there. What I'll do is I'll just dry that off with a fresh one on this side. And then we'll give it another go. And then we'll give it another go. I'll just dry that off with a fresh one on here. And then we'll give it another go with a newer bit. So let's get another cotton bud. Give it a quick dunk in the alcohol and we'll start again. I don't know why the alcohol apparently is not going to damage the metal. So it does appear to be getting a massive amount of gunk off of this, I'm not sure what it's called, the copper plate here, so, which is very good. Anyway, then what I'll do is I'll cut away now, and once I finish clearing it, I'll let you know what the next thing that I need to do is. So, I'll be back in a second. Alright, well, the other thing that I'm cleaning is the little connection rod, so I've just put a little bit of the alcohol again on the cotton bud and just giving this a little clean to make sure that this is coming up nice and clean. The alcohol should, I believe, be okay in terms of the insulating wire cover. So although I suspect somebody in the comments is going to tell me that I shouldn't have done that. However, there we go. So I've cleaned that particular little bit there. Going back to the engine, I've now cleaned most of the cleaned the engine around there. It may need another going over, and I may just do that. The next thing I want to do is to just, with a fresh cotton bud, is to just give this here a little once over, just to make sure that's nice and clean, although I don't imagine that there's going to be too much there. I think mainly the reason for cleaning and servicing it like this is to make sure there's a good connection in terms of the electrical connections. But again, once again, a fair bit of muck has come off of there, which is good. The final bit that I will need to do is, I mentioned that along in each of the areas here, the this bit here is separated by a small sort of groove there that I suppose acts as the the sort of cut off between the two areas. I'm hoping I'm not damaging this. So I'm just giving it a rub over with this bit of wire to make sure that they're nice and clean. They do look reasonably, as you can imagine, the bits off the brushes will tend to get into there. There's a little bit of fluff on there and I'll have to get some tweezers and pull that off. So anyway, there we are in terms of the cleaning of the motor. I will give it another go over, but you obviously don't want to watch me doing that. So what I'll do now is I'll move on to the main chassis bit. Well, the other area, I suppose, is the bottom of the engine, and the other area that's going to get quite dirty will be the wheels, where they're running on the rails, and that's obviously acting as the pickup as well. So what I intend to do is to just give those a clean at the same time. So I'll just turn it over and we'll put it on. So what I'm doing is just rubbing it on and then turning it gradually as I'm doing it. Hopefully that'll bring the get rid of most of the muck on the wheels. So what I do now is I'll carry on cleaning it, and we'll go back and see how the baseboards are getting on and see how the carpentry is getting on. Must admit, I'd much rather be doing this than all that soldering and drilling. Anyway, I'll see you in a bit once you're back. Thank you. So, just about to cut the last bit of wood. I've been cutting these strips to the right size, obviously taking off the width of that, because these are going to sit between the two main struts. You'll see that in a minute. I'll just double check once I've marked it that it is the same size by placing the previous bit of cut piece of wood up to it. And again, I'm cutting just outside the line so I can file down to make the or can sand it down to make it the right size rather than cut too short. Any of you that have watched a couple of the other videos of mine, and particularly the when I made the ant house series, which I suspect most of you don't watch as your railway modellers, but will have seen that when I was building the homemade ant's nest, I was using this particular tool. I do find it very, very easy to use, and tends to cut much better than using a jigsaw. Just what I find anyway. So, and there we are, the last cut. Just needs a bit of sanding down now with the sander, double checking the sizes, and then we can start putting the frame together prior to fitting the baseboard. So, I'll get all this sanded down and ready, so once we've done that, I'll be back. So here's the baseboard frame, almost complete. I've not actually attached the baseboard to it yet. I was just using that in order to make sure that the wood frame was square. I've just got the last few screws to put in. I'll just show you these going in. So that's where they're going to go. I'll just go around now and prepare to drill and screw those in. I have used screws and wood glue on each of the joins. So I put wood glue down first and then obviously screwed them in. I sink the screw holes initially with a small drill and then obviously put the screws in afterwards. And I'll show you that in just 2 seconds. So here's the next section. I've drawn a line down using the set square just to make sure I'm in the centre there. I did say I was going to try and do just 12 inches between them, but it looked a little bit cramped when I was doing that, so I've decided to do just a 16 inch gap from there. So there's one of the cross members every 16 inches. Using the line obviously as a guide, I'll just drill two. Screws, I'll put the bottom one in first. And then the top one. I'll just finish them off with a normal screwdriver. Split this to fraction. And there, just to make sure it's rolling. Well, and I think that is the frame of the baseboard done. All I've got to do now is turn it over and connect the actual baseboard with screws to the frame. So, whilst I'm getting ready to do that, Whilst I'm doing that, what I'll do is I'll hand you back and let's see if we can get that Class LH shunter running again. Thank you. Okay, and thanks. It does look as if the baseboards are progressing quite nicely. We're back to the problem with the 08 shunter, and if you can remember that there was a two wires that I've got here that were, one of them was disconnected. Well, thankfully people on the forum suggested that I review the servicing instructions and the diagrams, and it does appear that the brown wire which is connected to the red wire in the servicing diagram is actually just one single wire. So if you imagine that in the servicing diagram is just one single wire, it then goes down and feeds back through the chassis onto the plate at the bottom here. As we thought, it is actually one of the pickups, and it's actually connected to, and I'm not sure whether you can see this, but it actually connects to a rather small looking little lip here, so this little lip here that it's connected to. So I'm going to test my soldering skills, having never ever soldered anything really before. I've had a little tiny bit of practice at seeing what I can do. So this will be my first attempt, and it's quite a small little connection, as you can probably see there. So that wire there needs to connect to there. Can't even do it even when I'm not soldering, let alone when I am. So I shall give that a go now. I'll just set everything up and then we'll be back when we are ready to have our first attempt at soldering. Well, here we are, I'm using the third hand. I've got one of these non-clean flux dispensing pens. I'm hoping this will help in terms of the with my soldering skills. I did try it before, I'm never too sure whether anything's coming out, so I'm not sure whether there's any real way of telling. So I've fluxed up that, and I've already put a little bit of flux on the end of the wire. I'm just going to try and tin this wire now, and then I'll bring it back across and we'll see how we get on with this. So let's have a go at tinning the wire. I'm not sure whether that's tinned or not, whether I wiped it straight back off again. Let's have another go. A little bit of solder on the end of the... soldering iron. Get it clean, try again. I almost got there then. So I need to get that there. Let's try it now. Well, I think finally, I have managed to get it soldered on. Let's hope that holds. Wow, that was much more difficult than I expected it to be. However, it is on there. Now what I need to do is just remember how this goes. It goes up through there, doesn't it? So both of those. If this works, I will be truly amazed. Right, well there we go, that's all in place, so that one should be behind the wheel, not in front of it, there. Right, let's put the two, well, I don't know, two little screws back in, shall we? However, you could see that it was causing me a bit of a nightmare, but I have got it done. I'm just going to reassemble. Whether this works or not, I don't know. If not, we will have to wait till the next episode, won't we? Well, as you can see, we've got it assembled. All I need to do now is give it a quick oil. The oil I'm using is some sewing machine oil that someone suggested on a YouTube channel that this would be suitable. So I'm just going to put a tiny little drop of oil onto the various bits, and then we'll see if it's running. And in the meantime, I'll hand you back over and we can have a final look at the how we got on with the baseboards. Thank you. Well, thanks. That looked a little bit tricky and way beyond my skills at soldering. So here we are back with the baseboard, all done. I've checked it out with the level, and it all appears to be very nice and level. So all completed here, baseboard's all done. So all there is time to do now is to just say thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. Please do comment and let me know what you think of the video so far. If you do enjoy the video, please like, and if you want to see more of them, then please feel free to subscribe. What I'll do now is hand you back and we'll see if that 08 Shunter finally gets running after 40 years in a box. So, see you later. Well, here we are. We had to nip into the other room to set up a bit of track that we can try and work it on. I've tried running it with the old DC controllers that I had, Fortunately, I couldn't get anything, even any sign of life out of the engine when I put it on there. So using a digital one, using it on DC mode, we'll pop the engine on. It's going to hear a bit of life coming from the engine, and we'll turn him up and we'll see if we can get him running. And there we go. First time in 40 years he's running. I'm actually very pleased with that, and I'll leave you with a few shots of it running.